Good evening and welcome to our Fordham Ethics in Business seminar. I'm delighted to see so many of you here today, both in person and in online. For those who don't know me, I'm Miguel Alzola. I'm an associate professor of ethics here at Fordham University. Today marks another exciting episode in our seminar series, which we launched last year to foster an enriched conversation about normative business ethics, both in our region and globally. For our online audience, please feel free to engage with comments and questions via Zoom. We will have a question and answers session at the end, which the first part will be reserved for students' questions, both in person and online. This lecture will be recorded and made available on our seminar series website and on Fordham social media channels. It is my great pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker for today, Elizabeth Edenberg, who is an assistant professor of philosophy at Baruch College at the City University of New York. Elizabeth's work exemplifies the innovative and interdisciplinary research that is crucial to understanding some of the ethical challenges of our time. Elizabeth specializes in political philosophy, political epistemology, and the ethics of technology. Her research is recognized for its use in philosophical tools to address contemporary social issues, ranging from debates over justice and political disagreement to the impact of technology in our future. Her articles have appeared in our leading journals across philosophy, computer science, and science and technology, demonstrating the breadth and relevance of her work. In 2021, she co-edited the groundbreaking research volume on political epistemology published by Oxford University Press, which has significantly advanced our understanding of the intersection between politics and knowledge. Before that, she published a book on transitional justice, co-edited with Larry May and published by Cambridge University Press. Before joining Baruch, Elizabeth served as a senior ethicist and research professor at Georgetown University. There, she led innovative projects in translational ethics aimed at empowering both students and experts to tackle urgent contemporary issues. Her work included embedding ethics across the curriculum and collaborating with partners beyond academia, from public impact projects to policy teams seeking practical progress on complex issues. And before Georgetown, she was a professor here at Fordham between 2015 and 2016. Today, Elizabeth will be presenting her work on consent in the digital age, a topic of immense relevance in our increasingly digitalized world. Her lecture promises to bridge philosophical theories of consent with the realities of the digital realm, offering new insight into how to understand and practice consent in our online interactions. Elizabeth's work raises crucial questions for our field. How do we adapt our understanding of consent to the digital age? What are the limitations of our current theories of consent when applied to online environments? How can we ensure that consent remains meaningful and morally transformative in the digital sphere? These questions resonate deeply with our research. In a world where business primarily operates in digital spaces, understanding digital consent is crucial for policy formation, business decision-making, and for the protection of individual rights. Elizabeth's work offers us a unique opportunity to reconsider our assumptions about consent and its role in business ethics. Please join me in welcoming Elizabeth Edenberg. We look forward to her insights and the discussion that will follow.
Thank you all, and thank you all for having me. As Miguel mentioned, Fordham was actually my first job after I got my PhD, so it has a special place in my heart, so it's lovely to see you all. So today I'm gonna be talking about consent and securing rights in the digital age. So, there we go. Consent plays a pretty big role in our lives, and it plays a pretty big role across a lot of different public domains. So a lot of public discussion comes up around clearly sexual ethics, around contracts and contract law. Increasingly, the issue of consent's come up in regards to generative AI and the use of material without our consent. Comes up in property, comes up all over the place. So it plays a really crucial role in our lives. And the question is, what about consent allows it to play that kind of transformative role that it does? Because it allows us to do quite a lot of things. So this talk is going to be bridging a lot of work that has happened in philosophy with a lot of the work that's happening in tech and law from both computer science and legal perspectives. In philosophy, actually, the majority of the recent discussions about consent, these th theories of consent, looking at consent, its requirements, its normative force, have actually focused on, in particular, sexual ethics in light of a lot of the public conversations around that in the last decade or so. That often builds on a much older, very well-established literature on informed consent as it relates to medical research and clinical care. So there's actually quite a lot there. And I'll come back to this because it's actually interesting. A lot of the discussions around consent in digital technology, in fact, were developing in the United States at the same times that they were developing the Belmont Report, which has been hugely influential in establishing codes of medical ethics. So that's where a lot of the philosophical literature has been in more recent years. And then there's a much older tradition in philosophy, dating in particular in the early modern era, looking at consent in political philosophy, looking at this as a tool for securing the legitimacy of the coercive power of the government, thinking that there's a variety of ways to, in fact, check whether the government's legitimate, either through figuring out whether or not anyone actually consented. Not very many people think that you need actual consent to the government, but often through things like hypothetical consent. So, is this the kind of government that we could agree to were we to be given the choice, right? So, this is where a lot of the discussion has happened. I think you'll see it quite notably. A lot of the philosophical discussion hasn't mentioned, except for in some footnotes here and there, how this applies to our current digital realm. So that's part of what I'm trying to do in this piece. So the plan for the talk is that first I'm going to be drawing on literature from across all those philosophical areas to try to develop a taxonomy of the key features that explain what makes consent morally transformative. So I'm going to be synthesizing a lot of this and trying to pull out the features that we need for consent to work its moral magic. Then I'm going to apply it to the digital realm, right? I'm going to do that for two purposes. So I consider this to be a work in what I call translational ethics. So where you're actually going from theory to practice and back, that's borrowing from the sciences, where this is well known in terms of translational science research, which typically is bringing, bench level theoretical basic science all the way to clinical practice and back again. And so typically what's different about that is that both sides of the equations inform each other. And so that's partly why I call this a case of translational ethics, because it's not going to be merely a matter of saying, look at this philosophical theory, let me apply it. And look, we philosophers have solved all of these questions, right? Instead, I'm going to be trying to show the insights we get from philosophy, right? So looking at some of the ways that understanding these morally transformative features can actually help us correct some of the failures that we see in the digital realm. But I'm also going to be looking at how understanding the functions and failures of consent in the digital realm put pressure on some of our philosophical concepts to try to look at ways to revise our understanding of morally transformative consent. I'm going to suggest that digital consent actually suggests certain limitations in philosophers' understanding of consent. And I'm going to argue, in particular, that for consent to work its moral magic for individuals, we actually need these strong communal protections in the background. And so that's been a largely unnoticed feature of a lot of consent theories. So that's the plan. So let's get started. So, first, what is consent? So consent is this power of moral transformation. So what this does is it basically transforms the rights and obligations of the different parties to a consent transaction. Typically, a lot of the theories talk about this in terms of two, three-party models, where we have the person who's giving consent, right? You're being asked for your consent to do some specific thing. You're being asked by someone. So you're giving consent to some person or entity for some specific purpose. And then sometimes third parties come in terms of whether or not there's pressure from the consent receiver or third parties, but also just the nature of the transformation of the rights and obligations, even between those two parties, generate obligations on the rest of us, right? So if you're trying to enforce something like basic property rights, so if I'm asked to borrow Miguel's laptop and you just see me using the laptop, if you hear that, oh no, he agreed that I could borrow this, right? You're saying, okay, it's fine. If not, you say, hey, that's not yours, right? So it generates obligations on third parties as well. There's also two primary senses just to keep in mind. There's the sense of legally or institutionally valid consent. So this is would be what does the law actually require? What does this institution require? Presumably, if you meet that stated requirement, you're good from the legal and institutional realm. What I'm mostly going to be talking about is morally transformative consent, right? So what actually makes it the case that you've given real permission that makes it actually okay to proceed? So consent serves a variety of functions, right? It plays a role in a lot of different aspects of our lives, and that it does so in two primary ways. So a lot of the discussion focuses on the protective features of consent. So it protects against unauthorized invasion of people's body and property, right? We see this pretty clearly in cases of sexual consent, right? We also see this pretty clearly in cases of medical ethics, right? I happen to have very bad ankles. I used to dance. They're very messed up. And so I've had a lot of surgeries. And so what makes it permissible for the surgeon to operate on my ankles is that I've given very specific consent to undergo anesthetics for them to cut open my ankles and fix it. Right? They're both bad, but imagine I give consent only for my left one, which is the worst one. Just even though, the surgeon might know, well, your right ankle's also pretty bad, he's not justified in operating on both ankles, even if he thinks that I need it, right? So it looks like what is needed there is this consent to transform the obligation because it matters what is permissible and not, right? It can't just be what's beneficial to me, right? That's where we think consent, we have some amount of control over our bodies. Is that part clear so far? The other thing that it does is it facilitates voluntary interpersonal cooperation, usually with things that are, would otherwise be not permitted, right? This kind of permissive consent. So if we're collaborating and I ask to borrow your computer, right? It's facilitating some other end of mine. It's not really some protection of my body or my property, right? But it is a protection of your property, right? Similarly, we can see in sexual consent, right? There's an aspect in which it's protective, but there's also an aspect in which it's facilitative, right? It allows you to agree to more intimacy with people of your choice on your terms, right? This facilitates different kinds of action that otherwise would be prohibited. It also facilitates cooperation over time, right? So think about the consent that happens in promise making. So it's something that happens where if I agree to come pick you up at the airport, right, I have in some sense consented. Oh yes, I will come pick you up. There's a sense in which that's an aspect of consent that's binding on my future obligations, right? I've made you a promise. You can hold me accountable to it. Right. So it serves a lot of these important protective purposes. And so to figure out what actually transforms that relationship, when would it be legitimate for you to try to have a complaint against me, to try and force some sort of right, say that I have some obligation to you, it matters whether or not my consent has been morally transformative. So question is, what makes consent morally transformative? And here I'm pulling from a lot of the philosophical literature on this to try to pull out some of the key features that are largely agreed on. I'll talk about some of the ones that are part of more contested philosophical theories. And then I'll also talk about some of the features that are I will talk about some of the features that I think often go unnoticed in a lot of the philosophical theory that we're going to be more clearly revealed when we apply this to the digital case. So first, the orthodoxy, right? This is coming from Tom Doherty's recent book on consent and the scope of consent from Oxford University Press. So he explains that consent must be given by a suitably competent agent who's suitably free and has suitable comprehension of the terms of the transaction. So he actually uses a different phrase than comprehension, but I'm going to use comprehension for this. So this is what he declares as the philosophical orthodoxy, Right? So there's the competence, freedom, and comprehension. So the idea of competence here, it's meant to set some sort of minimal bar, right? So we think that there's often, we can set this in terms with some sort of age, right? Some age limit. So we think that you're sufficiently competent to consent. So if we go back to the medical case, and we're talking about some sort of surgery on a child, there often is pediatric assent. They try to get the child to understand and agree, but the legally enforceable consent is still given by the guardians, the parents. And that's because there's some sort of threshold of competence that needs to be met. It also involves some suitable freedom. And so there's a few aspects of this. So this will be freedom to choose amongst some set of viable options, as well as freedom to do this in some autonomous way, where I'm agreeing to do this without a lot of undue coercion or pressure. And suitable comprehension of the terms we'll talk about a little bit more. This is where there's a lot of discussion of informed consent and pressure around informed consent. But the idea is, it doesn't really make sense to say that I've agreed to something if I have no idea what I'm agreeing to or if I'm deeply mistaken about it, right? So there has to be some kind of uptake of this information and some comprehension. Obviously, a lot of variation on thresholds for different contexts as well. Another aspect that's part of the philosophical orthodoxy is it needs to be intentional, right? For consent to form this moral magic, it can't be the case that you kind of just like accidentally consent to something, right? Then some philosophically contested elements that I think are still broadly in the norms, but not everywhere. There's also a discussion. You can see that in the philosophical orthodoxy, quite a lot of that is looking at features that are internal to the consent giver. Right? These are often seen as things like mental state accounts of consent. Not always, because the freedom pushes sometimes outside of the agent. But when we're looking at this, sometimes there's always a discussion. There has some sort of expression or token of consent, right? Because some of what consent is meant to do is if it transforms the moral relationship between two parties, everyone else needs to know that it happened, right? And so there's some sort of expression or communication that has to have happened for consent. So that's, I think, broadly part of the orthodoxy, but it is a little bit more contested than the first set. The consent transaction, and this comes from Milan Wertheimer, I'll talk about this more later, should treat the parties in a fair way. So this is actually a theory that broadens out from things like mental state models and what they call this kind of autonomous authorization model, and instead tries to look at the bilateral nature of the consent transaction to look at both parties to ensure that both parties are being treated fairly over the course of this transaction, right? What's often assumed in the philosophical literature that tends to not be discussed as any kind of contested element. These are things that I would say think are clearly part of the philosophical orthodoxy, but they're generally just built in. So consent has a clearly defined scope of action. You have to consent to some specific action for some specific time for some specific purpose. Consent also operates against some clear background conditions. Those typically go a little bit unnoticed because we have pretty stable understandings of, you know, this is the extent of my body, right? That's pretty obvious, right? Property. We have pretty well-worn assumptions about that. So this is always operating in the background, and it doesn't often get theoretical attention, because most of the discussions have operated in a lot of contexts where we have pretty clear sense of what the norms of permissible and impermissible behavior are. And these are going to be some of the things that I think the digital sphere challenges. This making sense so far? Broad, quick summary of lots of philosophical literature on consent. So let's start to apply this to the digital realm. So first, I'm going to try to show how actually understanding the features of what makes consent morally transformative is actually really useful for amending our practices. And I'm going to also show how this kind of reveals the importance of some of the assumptions that I was pulling out earlier. And again, I kind of consider this to be this practice of translational ethics, so it's not going to be just a one-way application. So let's talk just briefly about why consent's important in the digital realm. So consent's really built into quite a lot of laws, and because of that, a lot of policies in businesses are meant to meet these laws. And so these laws are really thinking of consent as one of the key aspects of how we protect our data in the digital sphere. So I'll talk about Europe first, because they have some pretty advanced, the General Data Protection Regulation that went into effect in 2018 has consent as a central feature. So in that, they define consent as, and you'll recognize the borrowing from robust philosophical theories of consent here, as any freely given, specific, informed, and unambiguous indication of the data subject's wish by which he or she, by a statement or clear affirmative action, signifies agreement to the processing of personal data relating to him or her. Right? So we see a lot of the philosophical elements coming in, right? It's free, it's specific, it's informed, unambiguous. We have some clear expression, right? And this is seen as a matter of the data subject having some sort of control. We also, I mentioned that the other part of freedom is thinking that you have some freedom to choose amongst viable alternatives. One part of that is if you're consenting to something, you should be able to withdraw your consent at any time. So that's also part of the GDPR. Right, so the data subject always has a right to withdraw their consent at any time. The US is an interesting case because actually it was one of the early movers in this space. So the Fair Information Practice Principles, which are often referred to as the FIPS, in 1973, came out of the Health, Education, and Welfare Report. I think that's really interesting to see. It defines a range of principles for protecting broadly our data. Among them, consent comes in as a key place, largely for consenting to other uses, because they're kind of presuming this data is collected for some legitimate purpose, and then you're consenting to some sort of other use. I think what's really interesting to note is that these principles, 1973, health, education, and welfare, this was going on at the same time that the Belmont Report was developed, which is hugely influential in medical ethics in the United States and beyond, where there was a principle of informed consent being developed. And so I think you can see why consent, as it's thought to govern the digital sphere, is often a matter of trying to get people to have the sufficient information to be able to agree to this. So there's a lot of influence actually both ways here. So these are just guidance principles. They got enacted in 74 in the Privacy Act, which is, despite being rather old at this point, still the national act. We also have a lot of patchwork national acts for specific domains. So we've got specific rules around privacy as it involves our healthcare data, right? COPPA's around children's privacy protection. FERPA applies to you all in terms of the educational context, your privacy. The FCRA, in terms of Federal Credit Reporting Agency, there's very domain-specific privacy laws that are governing these, but it's unlike Europe, we don't have anything after the Privacy Act that's governing this kind of broad sphere. We also have the FTC, which enforces consumer rights. So our rights as consumers, often that's done in ways of trying to basically enforce the terms of service that are there and try to shift the terms of service to make them a bit more fair towards people, right? But it's definitely enforcing consumers' rights rather than as in the GDPR, that's enforcing the rights qua citizen. So that enforces your rights in a range of domains. There's also a bunch of patchwork state laws that are, some of which are enacted, some of which are going to be enacted or going to be enforced soon, and some of which are in development. So we've got a kind of patchy landscape. But in all of these realms, we see consent really being built off of understandings that come out of bioethics, because this is where there's actually quite a robust, not only philosophical discussion, there's a legal discussion, there's a lot of institutional practices. And while it's clearly contested in terms of you might think of the last consent document you signed at, say, you go to the dentist and you get x-rays, right? Here's the consent that you sign, right? So there's clearly questions around how good these practices are. But they're well-established practices that have often been used to modify and adapt into the digital realm. So, is that making some sense so far? So, how good is consent in the digital realm? So often this gets enacted in terms of notice and choice. So you'll get a lot of anytime you go to a particular website or you get some, get your phone, get a new app, go to something, there's sometimes privacy policies that you tend to just click through, right? So the idea here is the privacy policy is going to give you a notice, right? Here, all the ways that we're using your data, and choice in the sense that are you going to continue using this? Well, agree, right? It's gotten slightly better, actually, interestingly, in light of the GDPR, because the GDPR actually has forced some additional changes where you get some opting out. So this is where you'll see on some of these click boxes where you can look for more, right? And you'll get this sense of, oh, you can reject all of the unnecessary cookies, but you need to keep the functional ones and the necessary cookies. There's no opting out of those, right? It's not clear what amount of your data always is going into those. Of course, if you do some digging, I'm sure it's all written there and some nice legalese. But is that really the kind of notice and choice that we need for morally transformative consent? Seems pretty unlikely. So, the failures of consent have really been widely criticized in the legal and technical literature. There's broad skepticism that we should even be thinking about any of these things in terms of consent. So what I'm going to be trying to argue here is that understanding these features about what makes consent actually morally transformative is going to be useful for correcting some of the failures that happen in the digital realm. So I think we can actually take some inspiration from a clear understanding of the moral requirements of consent to work on making our legal and institutional practices better at seeking this purpose. Right? So let's go back to this. So I'm going to focus first on the philosophical orthodoxy as well as some of the contested elements. In particular, so there's not too much discussion about competence, right? There is, it's relevant if we're talking about the PAPA Act, but when we're talking broadly, it's not so contested about what some adult level of competence is required, nor is intentionality generally questioned so much. So I'm really going to focus on this question of the comprehension, the freedom, and then also whether or not the consent transaction treats people fairly, right? Because the communication is also pretty clear. There is at least some clear indication token of consent that happens. Let's start with comprehension. So I mentioned that a lot of the discussions of consent in the digital realm operate on the basis of notice and choice or notice and consent. Right? I think that it's pretty clear that also these are built, the laws and requirements are built on the model of informed consent in the medical case. Just as in the medical case, the informed part isn't necessarily, it's part of the relevant. We need information in order to comprehend. But if you emphasize more of the comprehension and less of the notice, I think we'll start to get towards better results, right? So we're asking about comprehension. We want to really understand if the consent giver actually understands the terms of the transaction. And for this needs more than just a provision of information, right? We need some actual comprehension, knowledge, understanding. Now, measuring this is going to be difficult, but it seems like it's going to point towards some ways to change the perhaps long legalese that's there, right? The ways in which it's really hard to even access some of the privacy policies. So when I teach consent, I ask my students to one exercise is just pick an app that you use often. Let's look at the privacy policies. Figure out what are the terms, how easy are they to understand, how easy it is to choose, right? Inevitably, sometimes there's some really easy, it's changed over time, right? Sometimes things have actually gotten better, so they'll give some short, high-level summary that's fairly vague, that's somewhat easy to understand, but the details are often in deep legalese. There's a lot of apps and websites that just kind of have boilerplate language. And so the kind of mere provision of information isn't enough. If we push towards comprehension, this can start to shift the requirements for what consent should be. Right? Another interesting fact, because this is now very dated. So 2008, McDonald and Craner calculated that it would take approximately 76 hours or working days, not hours, worse. 76 working days to read the privacy policies that individuals are typically exposed to in a year in 2008. We have way more now, right? So it's really just not even possible to do this. So even if you're trying to be really diligent, you basically couldn't hold down any job if you're like, excuse me, I just need 76 days to go through everything, plus or minus, right? Usually plus, right? So this looks like this is just not feasible. Also, there's been some interesting studies done, so this is just one example. A lot of people misunderstand the existence of a privacy policy to be an indication that the company cares about your privacy. And here's all the ways in which your privacy is protected. What the actual legal documents tend to do, however, are carve out all the ways in which we're using your data. It's not private, right? So there's a lot of tension on the comprehension, on the notice part. But I think if we push towards the comprehension, we're going to start to get some clearer guidelines about what actually is needed. This is very similar to the medical case. It's not really sufficient for some doctor to just give you a bunch of just deep medical jargon and count that to be that they've informed you in some sufficient sense for you to have transformative consent. So I think there's some room for progress here. What about freedom? So I'm going to break this into two parts. So voluntariness is what I'm going to talk about when we're talking about sort of the internalness, my own decision. Am I making this voluntarily? Am I making this freely? And then this kind of more external notion of freedom to choose amongst a range of viable alternatives. So looking more at the kind of nature of the consent transaction itself. So let's look at the voluntariness part. This looks like it's under significant pressure in the digital age, in part because so many of these apps are designed with specific intention to keep your attention, to keep you engaged. There's addictive technology. They employ a lot of psychologists to test to make sure. There's all kinds of personalization that happens to ensure that you specifically are engaged so that you stay on that particular app for as long as possible. That's because we're actually the products, where our engagement is useful because you can sell advertising to us. You can get a lot of information in terms of how we use it to make a broad range of inferences, right? So it's important to keep your attention, right? But those kinds of addictive technology designs put a lot of pressure on the idea that you are voluntarily using some app, even if, let's assume everything, you understand how it's being used, you understand the terms and everything, but now you're using it. Is this really free? In the context of addictive design, it seems maybe a little less clear. Often in cases of addiction, we think that that undermines the voluntariness of your choice, right? It doesn't mean that there can't be some moral responsibility that can get you totally off the hook, but it does look like it, cuts away a little bit at how voluntary it really is. There's also a lot of social pressures to adopt, right? So even if you might say, well, I really don't want to be on these. So you try to say, okay, I really am just going to stay off all social media. Right? There can be some social cost to that amongst your friends, but it also is pretty impossible, I would say, to opt out in the modern world, right? And this relates to the freedom to choose amongst a viable set of options. So there's a lot of limited viability to choose otherwise, right? So your school, the learning management platform, is dictated by this school. Your email is dictated by this school. Insofar as you all are enrolled, you have to use those services in order to access the relevant information. So the idea that you could opt out of any of the terms that are set by the university and the email provider of the university are pretty limited, right? This is true school, pretty much every job, right? Not just white collar jobs where you're spending a lot of time online, increasingly in, factories, warehouses, truck drivers. These are all increasingly digitally modern. And insofar as a term of employment, which I would say the vast majority of us need some sort of employment to live, right? There's not really an option otherwise. So the idea that you could opt out of some of these seems pretty under pressure. That's increasingly true in the Internet of Things, the smart future, Walking around the world, you're often being surveilled and monitored in ways that are going to undermine your kind of freedom to opt out from having this kind of data collected about you. Let's push a little more onto the transactional notion. So, do the two parties treat each other fairly? So, I mentioned that this comes from Miller and Wertheimer, and so they argue for it kind of comes out of their work in bioethics and sexual ethics, and they argue that actually some of these models of consent that are really based on an individual's autonomous authorization don't fit as well with the range of consent transactions and contexts in which to use consent. So they argue for a shift to what they call the fair transaction model, where they're really evaluating whether or not the two parties have been treated fairly, in particular, whether or not A has the person who is receiving consent, asking for consent, treats the person who's giving consent fairly. And they're interested in the transaction because there are some cases of flawed consent where it's the case that sometimes it's permissible to proceed even if you haven't given actually morally valid consent, if the transaction is fair, right? In some cases, a misunderstanding. There's also a question about what makes the broader context fair. And so this, I'm going to actually start to move on to how this is highlighting some of the hidden assumptions. So, consent has a clearly defined scope of action and operates against clear background conditions. So, the scope of action for permissive consent, generally, it's taken as a clear assumption that when you're given something like permissive consent, so this is when you're consenting to some particular action for some particular individual for some particular time, right? That's a clearly defined scope that's specified. The digital sphere very obviously challenges that, right? We've got really unlimited data and collection and use of our data, right? Often the thing that's taken as a clear standard, right? So Doherty, again, people do not give blanket consent to the performance of an action at any time in the future. That is exactly what you're doing in the digital sphere, right? You are giving up your data for some open-ended, future possible use, right? Probably because it's impossible to kind of contain once it's been up there. There's a lot of features of this. So also the background conditions. Typically these, again, so think of the moral magic. So that's Heidi Herd talks about the moral magic. It transforms, it does this magical thing. What's impermissible suddenly becomes permissible with my consent, specific, time-bound to a specific person, right? This is assumed in the literature without a lot of critical attention. So here's some examples. We don't need to go through all of them. Right. It really includes this idea that there's this clear moral default set because most of these contexts are again where we have pretty clear boundaries, including pretty clear background expectations in a way that we really just don't, right? Because while there's 50 plus years of discussion around this in the digital sphere, right, that's nothing when you talk about the clear norms and intuitions we have around our body and our property, right? So it's pretty much in its infancy, right? We're also challenged even more because the norms that we do have tend to be set by those who have a strong interest in using our data and taking our information. And as the technological capacities increase, so too do the possibilities, right? So we saw this just in generative AI that came out. So this became possible because there was so much data in order for it to learn in order to be able to generate, right? So these are new contexts. It was trained on a bunch of data that was already out there, right? And so there's a lot of kind of exponential increase and a lot of unknown future uses, right? So there's really unstable background conditions. So we might ask, so is this context fair? It does seem that we need to focus on what the background conditions should be. We're going to need to have some understanding of what should we want, how should we establish what's permissible, what's not with our data. So we do have, I mean, it's infancy, 50 years, but we do have 50 years of understanding. We use technology so pervasively. It's worth having a public conversation around what should the permissible norms be, always revisable, but it would be helpful to have a broader understanding set, not necessarily anchored by the companies that have an interest in violating privacy, but by us as citizens to figure out what should those norms look like in order to hold those standards, right? So there, I'm going to try to pull on questions about institutional and structural justice. I think questions of Rawlsian justice fairness is useful. I won't get into them in this talk. But I think there's some interesting inspiration that can happen from a lot of the discussions of legitimacy in political philosophy, because there too, we see a lot of contexts that are very similar, turns out, because there it's not like we have an option to opt out of any sort of state coercion, right? You're going to have to pay your taxes, you know, but what makes those kinds of laws legitimate? There's a lot of discussion of that. So I think that we can actually borrow from this less 2%, two or three party interaction to look at these conditions where you have asymmetries of power, you have asymmetries of knowledge, and can try to adjust on that basis. So let's talk about how to revise some of these theories. So I'm gonna be arguing that we actually need to have these strong communal protections in place for our rights to actually operate. So let's look at a common case. So we've been talking about permissive consent. In particular, there's a lot of discussion around authority retaining permissive consent. So what this means is we have this clear domain where we have rights. So think our body, our property, right? And generally the permission we're given is just lasting only so long as we allow it, right? So if I'm letting you borrow something of mine, so Miguel lets me borrow his laptop, right? It's generally, he let me borrow it for some specific time, for some specific purpose, and he can always be like, you know what, I need it back, right? Because he hasn't given me the laptop and reneged his rights. It's this permissive control, right? Similarly, there's always the ability, think consent and sex. You can always withdraw at any time, right? You can say, I no longer consent to this, right? You retain because your use of your body is entirely up to you, right? You can withdraw this at any time for any reason, right? It's entirely up to you. So this happens in most of the cases that we talk about consent, right? The well-established literature on consent has this authority retaining permissive consent. So it's interesting, it's tricky, but it looks like it has some rough boundaries that you are not relinquishing your authority. Right? It's also assumed to happen in the digital realm, but it really doesn't happen. So let's see why. So one, data can be really personal, right? We've got a wealth of data, which allows us to draw inferences on the basis of seemingly completely innocuous use, right? And those inferences can be the kinds of things that you wouldn't share with very many people. Right? Your mental health. There's been discussions, interesting studies where just the ways and frequencies and patterns of words that you say on social media and your patterns of liking can give people quite good indication of whether or not you're depressed or anxious. And those can be manipulated as well. Right? You can have a pretty clear understanding of your sexual preferences from a lot of the ways that you use a lot of your technology. And easily, though we don't think about it a lot, your exact location can be known at every time that you have your cell phone with you, even if you have most of or all of the location services turned off, because one of the features about how you can use it in emergency situations, you know that is actually precisely tracking your location, right? So those aren't the kinds of things that you would generally want to share with anyone, because you wouldn't have any type of, think just stalkers, think anyone you're trying to avoid. You don't want everyone to know your specific location at any time, and yet it's very easily revealed pretty constantly in the digital sphere, right? Also, you might think, well, good, I'm going to opt out of all these things. But it turns out your data really isn't just yours. As personal as it is, it's actually shared with everyone. So obvious examples, so you agree to something like 23andMe, right? That implicates everybody who you're biologically related to. Your photos indicate everybody else who's in the picture and those that might be notably absent that are supposed to be there, right? Your contacts give information about both of you, right? The less obvious reality is actually our current ecosystem is actually tailor-made to draw these sweeping inferences. There's been interesting studies that it requires only about 20% of a representative population to participate in giving their data in order for information substantial good inferences to be drawn about all the rest of us. Right? So it looks like it's not, well, as personal as this information is, it's also really not in your control because it's not just about you, right? So you can't just protect your risk by withholding, right? There's going to be plenty of inferences still drawn about you, even if you have the highest privacy settings, do everything you can to opt out, right? And it looks like even though we think about kind of permission given in terms of domain rights and our own personal information, it functions much more like pollution, right? All the data around the people around you are spilling is polluting your water too, right? And it's pretty far from obvious that we can do much about it with the tools we have. So I'm working with a group of computer scientists and lawyers on some project to try to help shift the balance of power, kind of leverage these collective notions in a way that can help change and give a little bit more control collectively in a way that we personally can't. But it's still, that's a tricky project, and it also is not clear that it's going to do enough. You might be wondering, okay, you've given so many problems with consent, why think about consent at all? You'd be in good company. Helen Niesenbaum, one of the very famous philosophers who work on this technical sphere, just says, yep, stop thinking about consent. It's not possible. It isn't right. It's the wrong kind of notion to engage. I do want to retain this, despite all the problems I fed, right? In part, I've argued that there are ways to help shift and improve some of our practices to make them better, closer to the kind of morally transformative consent that we should want, right? But it also just is a key feature of a lot of privacy and data protection laws. And it's actually often used as an important lever in enforcing our digital rights. I think we see that very clearly in the case of generative AI. It's very interesting when you dig into these cases, looking at intellectual property, electronic communications, various state laws, consent comes up all the time in the lawsuits against generative AI, right? And so to just say, well, consent doesn't work, right? It kind of kicks out one of the key legal standings that we have existing to try to protect our rights. So I think that that pragmatically is a reason to think that consent maybe can be retained if we can revive it some rather than just toss it. But I think it needs to be changed not just in terms of looking at what the moral features are, but looking at how these are not just between two or three people, but instead these questions about legitimacy from political philosophy. So look at these background conditions, right? We need to understand what makes some particular data use legitimate or not, set some clear norms. That needs to be a broad social conversation about all the different parties that are affected by this, with particular attention to those who are typically marginalized and exploited, right? So only after we have these kind of clear backgrounds can we think that consent can play this important role, but I think that it still should retain that importance. And I think the benefit of keeping consent is it does give us this special thing. It's why a big feature of a lot of parts of our lives, right? So we want there to be some sort of background assumptions so that we can deviate from them, so that you have some option to do what you want, right? We have to understand how our choice affects others. But I do think that there's a reason consent has such a pervasive role in our lives, right? Because it allows us to deviate from sort of broad permissions given and broad expectations. We can kind of fit to what we need. So I think that's a key thing to retain. You might wonder, okay, so is this just unique to consent? I would say no. I just think this is an unnoticed feature of consent. So this idea of the collective protection of our rights as a necessary feature for our ability to have consent have any moral meaning, I think happens very clearly in the cases that lots of people talk about, right? So the case of sexual ethics, it seems pretty clear that the collective action and the changes that we've had around what's permissible and what's not have been deeply informed by the collective protection of rights, right? So these collective protections really enable consent to have its moral force. Similarly, in medical ethics, right? So you can see, so this is from Tuskegee, right? So some of the medical ethics cases have come out of clear abuses, right? So this is a case where individuals were studied with syphilis just in situ long after there was an effective treatment, right? What's going on there is not just some failure of informing. So there is a failure of informing and a failure of informed consent. But what's also going on there is a failure to have broad protection of the Black individuals who were affected by this, right? So what changed were, and what importantly changed, was not just some requirements for informed consent, but broad communal protections to think that everybody is entitled to some sort of control and health of the body, right? So I think that these features of trying to shift from these individual notions to the broader context is relevant in actually all of these cases of consent. So just leave the conclusion up there. So I've basically tried to give you some understanding of some of the features of consent, apply this to the digital realm, both to show how it can help, what it reveals about moral, morally transformative consent, and then start to push on what limitations these are and how we might fix them through looking at various notions of strong communal protections for individual rights. And there's a lot more to be done. Thanks so much. Appreciate it.
We do priority to the students' questions and comments first. So,
Can you take the cue?
also, they can hear? Oh, yes. Yeah.
Okay. The microphone is there on that TV, so you need to speak out for people in the
For the people on the Zoom?
Yeah. This is the mic?
Oh,
on the camera.
yeah.
Okay, so just a reminder that those on the Zoom call, we're giving priority to students coming first. Questions? Comments?
Have to put that up.
How much of the self theory do you think can be applied in a practical sense?
Great question. Yeah.
Can we state the
Oh,
question
yes.
for
How much of the philosophical theory can be applied in a practical sense, right? Yeah, that's a great question. Because you would think that a lot of philosophy might be too abstract or high-minded to really be practically applicable. So I think that that's I don't think that has to be the case, right? I think consent is actually one of these really interesting ways that we can see that really robust philosophical thinking has informed the practical context. So we see this really clearly in the long history of bioethics, right? So this was there were actually quite a lot of philosophers that were involved in developing some of these codes of research. There are continue to be philosophers that sit in clinical settings and research settings evaluating broadly kind of requirements and ethics around research, clinical care, and the rest. So I think that that gives some kind of like proof of concept that it's possible to have these kind of practical applications. I do think that there will be, and I do think with this, I've tried to point to some of the ways that understanding what makes it morally transformative can help give guidance towards ameliorating and improving some of the failures. That's not going to say that I would expect like new institutional rules or new laws to satisfy everything we need for morally transformative consent, right? Because often you might think that the moral requirements are set at a certain level, and we tend to set the legal requirements and institutional requirements a little bit less. Sometimes, right? Because we don't always legally require through kind of some course of action people to be actually moral, right? Have some sort of moral threshold. But I do think basically right now we're sort of like here, right? Like there's some moral requirements and they're not all speaking to some of the legal requirements, even though there's some connection, right? And some of the institutional instantiations of it. So some of the law actually looks closer to philosophy, but some of the instantiation has been really deeply questioned. So I think there's a real role for kind of bringing them together. It's not going to say that every institutional aspect is going to be some morally transformative consent, in part because there's a lot of cases of kind of flawed transactions where you might think that the person who's asking for consent has done their best on any sort of measure, the revised, improved institutional measures, right? There's sometimes that's all that you can do because you can't always get into somebody's head to figure out how well do you really understand. If you give me every indication you understand it, right? Maybe that's all I can do. So there could be some reasonable kind of deviance. Does that help get at your question? Yeah, great question.
We have a question from Zoom,
Great.
from Santa. Can you elaborate more on the part that data is only needed from 20% of us in order to assume about the rest of us? Does this only go for digital information?
Oh, yeah, that's interesting. So I know that it's especially true. So that's coming from, try and just go there if it's helpful, about your personal data, right? The data isn't just mine. So I guess I'll keep it here, right? So with this, right, there's a recent study, and I'm forgetting the name of the authors at the moment, so I'm sorry. I can find it, you can follow up with me, and I can send it to you. But there have been some recent studies in particular about digital information in light of all of the vast information that we have from the, you know, everything we're using this technology pretty ubiquitously. And so I think the studies have been done in particular on social media platforms, where it is the case that as long as you have a representative sample, which matters, right, there's some threshold where you can actually, with just some people agreeing to give all of their information, there's enough similarities. Because as much as we talk about algorithmic personalization and the idea that things are tailored just to you to keep you interested, we're not quite as unique or special snowflakes as our moms might have told us when we were growing up, right? Because it turns out that we're quite similar to many of our friends, people who share a similar socioeconomic status, similar backgrounds. And so that allows a lot of more inferences to be drawn. So I'm happy to share that information. But it does seem, even if it's not just the mere 20%, which does come from a recent study, it is pretty easy to draw inferences on the basis. Some people agreeing, you can infer that about everyone similarly situated. Does that help?
I had a question myself.
Yeah, I have a question. So based on the time you said that it takes, so, for example, to read the terms and agreements,
yeah,
I think AI could assist in that. And also, yeah,
super interesting.
If AI was utilized, right, so like it gives you a summary of however many pages.
Yeah.
How would that like affect lawsuits, like breach of contract, and what makes the contract void, and also like I think it's called procedural conscionability, like for fine prints, like how would that alter that?
Great question. Yeah. So the question is, how does, I'm just gonna try and summarize. So how does AI actually potentially help and transform this idea that it takes so long to read all these policies, and how might that affect other sorts of business practices like breach of contract and the rest? Is that it? Okay, great question. So actually in previous work, I've argued that all of these kinds of features of, we look at what makes consent morally transformative, it doesn't necessarily mean that everything's worse, because there are potential for AI to be quite helpful in this, right? And in particular with the comprehension. So I actually agree with you that there are aspects that we can see the improvements in AI being able to be really helpful, both in terms of summarizing things so that you can understand, with some back and forth, right? So you can imagine some companies, it would need to be close enough, like tied closely enough to what's actually happening. So you can imagine companies maybe building some sort of AI agent to help you interact, right? So what we envisioned, this was published in 2018 and 2020, so it was before ChatGPT, but we were envisioning was, you know, what if you have some kind of conversation? So Alexa can tell you like, hey, Alexa, hey, Siri, hey, Google, tell me something, right? You can imagine doing that kind of discussion with some sort of AI agent to help, as long as it's, again, tied to the actual privacy policies information. It looks like it's facilitating more of a cooperative transaction than what currently exists in the kind of digital platform. And I think that that actually would be really interesting, because it's actually taking some model of what we think is useful about people having a conversation with their doctor. Because presumably, again, the better version, not just the assign this and then go on to treat, but the better version where you're saying, okay, do you understand this? What questions do you have? You can imagine doing that with some sort of AI agent in a way that can significantly improve at least this comprehension point. Another potential would be, some people are working on things like privacy assistance. So you can imagine some sort of, you set some privacy assistant for you, thinking specifically about the Internet of Things. So here are my general kind of preferences around privacy, and you have that, so set it on your phone, since we always have our phones with us, right? And then it would imagine, you upright in the world, and it would notify you when you're being, videotaped, and it would give you some kind of negotiate. You can imagine the devices negotiating with each other about protecting information. So yeah, so I do think that there's potential there too. I would just be cautious about pure technical optimism, because I think that there is a lot there, but we'd want to look for what the new problems are. We'd want to make sure that these are being accurate, that these are actually giving you the kind of information, but it seems like it could do something. Yeah, so it's super interesting.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I really enjoyed your talk. I guess I had two related questions. One was that you started off with a distinction I really liked and I'd want to retain between morally transformative consent,
yeah,
institutional consent. But then in sort of defense of morally transformative, you say, well, it's really useful in enforcing our legal rights, right?
Uh-huh.
Which seems institutional. And then you seem to end on a place where we need institutions in order.
Yes.
So how do you see that those things, are we just collapsing that distinction? You're going to reject the first distinction you made? Or?
Oh, yeah, super interesting, yeah. Because I do think that they come apart, right? Because the legal requirements are just, they're modeled after the moral requirements and the institutional requirements, but they tend to come apart for some of the reasons in response to the first question. But I do think we need something like institutional change. So when I was going, sorry. Takes a minute to go through here. Right, when we're thinking about this broader context of the institutions, it looks like I might push back towards some sort of institutional context. What I actually mean here is still to talk about morally transformative consent, but pay attention to these notions from political philosophy that are still going to talk about what are the moral requirements, right? But instead, we're looking at the requirements insofar as they fit institutions and structures. So you might think with questions of institutional justice, think about what sort of policies should be established, but we might not just think about what does some kind of business or institution or government actually say, but what ought the structures look like, which would still push you to that kind of moral notion. So I did have that in mind, but I for sure wasn't clear about it. Does that help?
Yes, sir.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for the talk. I have a question related to why Helen Nissenbaum is trying specifically to get rid of the word consent.
Mm.
Because I think that it maybe I have read a lot about her, but she wrote.
Yeah.
And then I think maybe it's in line with my privacy expectations, right?
Okay.
But then I also think that it's in line with she believes in that it's not possible, a real consent is impossible.
Yeah.
And then how can we really obtain consent in the matter of the other one is understanding or has a clear understanding of what they are accepting? And that's in line with his question, right? But then when using, and this is the last thing, when using the medical example, then it comes to my mind this paper of Michelstein of why principles and law cannot guarantee an ethical AI.
Yeah.
Where that paper he says, well, it's not possible because we are using these principles, using the bioethical principles, right?
Yeah.
But then there are many arguments against why we can't do that. The one that I can remember is that, well, a physician wants your health, you also want your health, but a firm and you don't, both of you don't have the same goal, right?
Yeah.
So it's impossible to use that to bolster in principles in bioethics and maybe to bolster consent in medical ethics is also complicated.
Yes. Absolutely. So I heard kind of two questions. So one is a little bit more on why Nissenbaum really rejects consent. And then the other deeper question is looking at this kind of skepticism that we should retain consent for these reasons that medical consent, even though there's plenty of problems with it, right, you still have the benefit that the doctor and the patient are at least aligned in terms of wanting your health. And in the digital sphere, you usually have very disparate interests from the people and actually pretty diametrically opposed interests, insofar as a lot of business models are built on collecting a lot of our data, and that's not the thing that many of us would want. Does that roughly, yes, just presume, get them?
Yes.
Yeah. So I'll start with the Niesenbaum question. So she gives, so in an earlier paper than this one that I'm pointing to, she and Solon Barakas argue for all the ways in which basically consent and anonymity really just get broken in the current context of the capabilities of the data sphere right now. So they talk about it in the context of big data. We can see it just kind of all of the, you know, ubiquitous data collection that we have. So they think that a lot of the practices around anonymity just don't work because there's plenty of re-identifiability. There's plenty of, you know, while it might not use my name, there's still persistent identifiers that can link me to all kinds of information. And in the consent case, it looks like some of the requirements around information, but it looks like the ability, they push against the idea that consent's useful for privacy because they also push against the idea that privacy is about control of our information, right? And so they, in particular, think that a lot of the dominant models think that, and you can see it in some of the legal requirements, if the whole reason is that I get to consent to some other use, it's because I get to control my information. Right. And Niesenbaum, in her book and a lot of other work on contextual integrity, try to argue that that kind of individual control model, it doesn't work. And she pushes for this idea about privacy being a matter of contextual integrity. So we ought to look for, so she'd actually support things like we have different sorts of rules around privacy, social norms around privacy when it comes to our healthcare than it does when it comes to sort of buying property and business negotiations. So it's kind of looking at those aspects. So that plays into why she thinks that consent really doesn't work, because consent sort of, she sees it as really built on this kind of personal control. So some of what I've tried to suggest is that consent doesn't, you know, it does push against the personal control model, but I think we still should retain some of that, because I think we still get that kind of background. And I actually want to argue that this kind of, her notion of privacy as contextual integrity points to actually one of the key essential features of consent rather than some alternative, because consent really does only operate with really stable understanding of the background conditions of norms of use. But I want to retain consent because it lets you navigate within those boundaries, right? So we can all agree on something, but you might have some differences. And I think we want to retain your, we want the strong collective rights that need to be built, right? But we want to still enable people, like you should be able to navigate differently within some boundaries. That makes sense. And then the second question, also interesting. So like the different alignment, right? This is in part where I think there can be quite a lot done from the perspective of companies, but they're not going to be aligned with our interests as citizens. So this is where I think some of those discussions around the background conditions have to be done by a pretty inclusive, like deliberately chosen, so that you're making sure that you highlight some of the people that are most marginalized, most exploited by particular uses, to try and set some broad discussion around permissible and impermissible use, because I think that's going to have to come from kind of society in a sense, so that we can have a clear understanding of what our interests are. And we'll probably need some laws and institutions to be built on that basis. And we see that at working, because in Europe, you know, there have been changes when you consider your rights qua citizen. I'm not saying that just adopt the GDPR, but that's just an example of kind of citizens' rights trying to set some enforceable, legally enforceable norms that businesses then have to adapt to come closer to protecting our rights. Does that help? Yes. Both questions?
Just kind of building on that. So there's this distinction between providing information and like comprehending, having a knowledge of what kind of consent. And I'm just wondering if you can ruminate a bit on like the deeper existential implications of that. Like, does the consent giver, do they understand the value of privacy? Like both in general and for them in particular, right?
Yeah.
And so you may give me all the information about how these tech companies are gathering my information, drawing inferences and so on. But then the normative question is like, why does that matter? Or why should that matter to me?
Yeah, definitely. So there's a question about sort of how do we, so part of the question was how do we ensure that people actually understand it, right? And the other part of the question I'm hearing is, especially if we're looking at comprehension rather than just the provision of information, the other part of it is, how do you ensure that people actually do sufficiently care, right? Because what some of the background assumption is that I'm sort of assuming that we should all care somewhat about keeping, having some kind of assumptions about what is done with our data. On the first question about the comprehension versus the provision of information. So it is much easier to see what kind of information is provided, what kind of, the potential to actually improve the comprehension through some sort of interactive features using something like AI to help engage a conversation. So you can do things that will come closer to getting you to understand, but we can't really, you could test, right? But some things you might not want to implement because that might set the bar too high. Who knows, right? There are ways that we test comprehension in other settings. Obviously, in the academic setting, right? Because you guys get tested all the time for how well you comprehend things, right? So I think that there's a way to look at what institutional rules should be set that come closer to meeting this moral requirement of comprehension rather than just the mere provision of information. It's going to change the types and forms and the way that we maybe do it. But you're right, we're not going to always have some clear indication of what's going on inside my head, right? And I think that's fine in a sense. I don't think that we should have things hinge on what's going on entirely in my own head. So I don't particularly side with the mental states kind of account of consent because I think that's difficult to enforce for a lot of reasons, and it's impractical even in terms of morally transformative consent because there needs to be some way for the consent receiver to know. So that's kind of the first part of your question. The second part, why should we care? Right? So say, you've studied all this, you know this, and then you just say, I just don't care about my privacy, right? And especially in the context of if enough people that are different enough from each other do that, then we can learn a lot about all of us who do care, right? So I think that's a separate question that might not fully be answered in terms of some sort of theory of consent, but it certainly is going to be important for trying to protect privacy and protection in general around data use. I do still think, though, even though it's going to be a slightly separate question, that the mode of trying to look at this broad public discussion about various background norms and assumptions, what should happen with our data, that has to be done in a broad context, right? So there's times that, some individuals don't care so much. Can we set up the society in a way that, say you don't care about privacy at all, like you can still navigate your world without caring, right? While not violating the norms of the rest. So it's going to change, require a lot of change, especially in light of a lot of things that we're learning about how inferentially rich data can be. But I don't think it's impossible. So I would think it would go in a similar kind of mode. But that's part of why I want to keep consent, because I do think with the right kind of setup, we should allow people to kind of do what they want within clear, structured norms. Yeah.
Our colleague David Bauman has a question in the chat. It's a long question. Do you want to read yourself and so the people can listen to that?
Do you want me to ask it?
Oh,
sure, yeah.
Yes.
Sure. The miracle of technology, right?
There you go. Hello.
So, yeah, I appreciate the talk and how you're trying. I think this whole field is trying to figure out what frame to or narrative to put around this type of electronic consent. And so my question is, is digital consent sort of maybe like property? If I'm at a Denver Nuggets game, on my ticket it says they may put my picture on the news or something or on the big screen, right? And so by me being on their property and I've got that ticket and I've been informed, they can use my image. And the same thing, if I'm using Facebook or Google as a property, every time I use it, I'm consenting, if you will, to them using my data. And at least they let me decide how much can be used or held on to. So what do you think of this whole idea of property as a frame? Because it does seem like there are a lot of apps I don't use, so I am not consenting to them using my data, but the properties that I am on, yeah, I guess I am consenting because I'm getting a free service.
Yeah, really interesting. So there's a couple aspects of it. So I think the idea about you sort of I would still kind of scare quote consent that happens when you're just here's this ticket we're going to use by coming to the game you agree to have your image used, right? There's a lot of instances where you see this kind of non-negotiable sort of consent. So the only way you could avoid that is to not attend, not use Facebook, something else. That's a kind of pressure that leads people to think that consent just doesn't work at all in this context because you're kind of just giving up the game about, if this is the only viable option. So this actually relates, I don't know if anyone here. So I think it relates to this kind of freedom to choose amongst a viable set of alternatives, right? So when there's really limited viability to opt out, I think that puts pressure against the idea that you consented in any sort of morally transformative way to this kind of option. So maybe you don't have to go to the game. That's a little bit easier, perhaps. You can watch it on TV, say, versus, while you can clearly not be on Facebook, you can't opt out of all kinds of digital platforms. And then the idea that there might still be inferences drawn around you, even when you aren't on any of these platforms, I think presses against this kind of freedom to choose and that we should think of that as consenting in any robust sense at all. The other part of your question that I was hearing a little bit with the just built into that, if I'm using Facebook, the property of Facebook or Google for free, right? There has been a lot of discussion around whether or not we ought to monetize some sort of exchange of, oh, well, these, multi-billion dollar companies are all doing this on extracting our data, so why don't we get some use out of it? So some of the discussion is, why don't people pay us for this use of data? I think some of that isn't going to go as far as people want, right? Though having, it turns out, while individual data, as inferentially rich as it is, isn't super useful without a lot of other people's data. So you might get paid almost nothing for yours because it's yours. There's an argument to be made that your data isn't particularly valuable, so much as everyone's data is valuable. So I think there's some pressure on just the pay people for like data as labor kind of movement. So I think that that's not the way that I would want to go in this. So I don't know if that gets at everything there, but the last part with the property norms, right? A lot of consent does operate in looking at kind of differences between norms of property and the rest. So that's where we have some fairly stable consent norms there, sort of this borrowing versus giving versus selling. We've got some relatively stable norms around property. I think it's different when we're talking about like surveillance, really, because it's not necessarily so entering the property, you're then being surveilled. I think that raises a different set of questions that we have far less stable intuitions about. Does that help?
Yeah, and I appreciate you bringing up, at our university, we have to use Microsoft 365.
Yeah, there you go. I didn't remember which
I have
one
to
it was.
use
We do too.
Outlook. But when it comes to Android, I can get rid of certain software. I can use graphene or something else. I can put all kinds of blockers on. It's a lot more work. But I do like the idea that, sure, if I'm being forced to use something, then my consent is really reduced,
Yeah.
as opposed to me going to a website and then I'm sort of using their property. So yeah, I appreciate your distinction there.
Question. Yeah. So I have a question in common, but So the question is about the clarificatory question about the first part of your talk. So, and your theory of consent, can I consent to a rights violation? It seems to be meeting your conditions.
Oh,
but
interesting.
There is something counterintuitive about that.
Yeah, consent to some sort of rights violation. I'm going to go back to your meaning all the way back here, right? This, oh, let me get rid of this so you can see. Sorry. Yeah, so on if these are the requirements of morally transformative consent,
yeah.
Right? Can I consent to rights violation? So I think one thing that's really interesting, because I think one thing that a morally transformative consent does is it actually makes something that would otherwise be a rights violation not in terms of your consent, right? So I gave the case of the surgeon, right? Like if any of you, despite knowing my ankles are bad, walk up to me with a knife, you're clearly violating my right. Right? So like the same action is a violation of rights insofar, and even if the surgeon tried to do this, he's violating my right if I haven't consented. So that's part of the moral magic of consent is it does, it's meant to, when it's morally transformative, actually transform something that would be a rights violation into something that wouldn't.
Would you be okay with me? So would you say that I can consent to be sold into slavery as
okay,
well?
Good. So
for
that's a different...
That,
yeah, but that's a different one, and it comes back to actually these same sets of requirements here, because it looks like, so the reasons that we say that people can't legitimately consent into being sold into slavery is because you're consenting to give up any sort of competence, authority, sort of sense of the very requirements that are needed for consent, and so that's the reason that people are often said that you can't kind of consent into those kinds of things, because you can't consent to give up all of your rights. So that's why we do it, because it should be related to these same kind of features, right? And we would worry, like there would be reasons on all of these to worry. If you're saying, yeah, I consent to being sold into slavery, we would wonder, okay, like, are you actually competent? Do you really understand what you're doing? You're giving up all rights for forever. How much are you being coerced into this, right? So we see this in these cases of like human trafficking, right? So even if you sort of agree, right, there's usually strong coercion, strong dependence in ways that we think that like mere verbal agreement isn't morally transformative. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Great
yeah.
question.
A lot of the time I ask, but also you could say that consent doesn't need to do all the moral work. So
yeah.
Yeah. It could be possible to say, yeah, you can consent to that, but there's other reasons why that's like impermissible. So
yeah. Oh, definitely. And yeah, I probably should have said that too. I want to say that you can't give morally transformative consent to that. But yeah, also consent shouldn't be doing all of the work. It's one amongst a bunch of different other kinds of rights protections, because I think that's maybe one of the other problems of the way consent operates in the digital sphere. Right now, it's like put so much heavy burden on this, right? This is the mechanism that a lot of people are using for talking about any kind of protection of our information that might be putting way too much on some mere mechanism of consent. So that actually aligns with Nissenbaum's worry there too, is that, you know, you can't ask it to do all that much. I just want to say that doesn't mean we should get rid of it entirely.
And then if I can make the comment. So yes, about the transformational power of consent. So it seems that this is close to what David was saying before. I mean, the whole project relies on this continuity between bodies,
yeah,
property, and data or whatever.
Yeah.
But it, there is a transformation because there is a sort of, and you describe it well, there is a sort of well-established right to your body,
yeah,
and presumably to your property,
yeah,
that is not so well-established in the case of the
yeah,
digital sphere, right? So don't you need to first establish the existence of those rights in order to make the case for the transformative power of consent. And
yeah,
the reason why I think it's important is because, not in your paper, but in your presentation, that what I got was a sort of strong deontological case implicit when you are talking about bodies and property, and in more of a welfare-based or harm-based arguments when you are talking about what is that personal data is important.
Yeah,
so
interesting.
You see what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. So how much do I need to rely on the kind of the continuity between bodies and property in the digital sphere? is one question. And then the other question about kind of the normative background. So the bodies and property looks like I'm relying on really deontological, kind of like clear rights, autonomy based notions, whereas in the digital sphere, I kind of switch towards like welfare things. So great questions. So for the first one, so I'm trying to at least draw together the features of what makes consent morally transformative from the existing literature, which is on mainly norms around bodies and property, right? Because I do think that that gives us the way that we've kind of, consent plays this huge moral role in our lives, and there's a lot of really well-developed, really great literature on what gives it that kind of property in these well-worn contexts. Right. So yeah, in some sense, I'm kind of taking from all that to say what really does make consent morally transformative. But I do think there are challenges in translating to the digital sphere because it is different, like not least of which because it's newer. We don't have these well-worn boundaries. So yeah, part of what we need is, and that's part of the argument that has to happen, is these things that have been assumed, right? Clear scope of action, clear background conditions, they're not operative really in the digital sphere. So we do need to have actually a lot of work on what those norms ought to be, right? And what I want to say is that work isn't, I mean, it's not like identical to consent, but it's certainly a part of consent, right? Like consent doesn't work without that. So yes, there's differences, and yes, we need to pay attention to that. But I just want to suggest that this is more a part of consent and has always been than what we thought, at least for the first part of your question. Second question there about sort of the different normative underpinnings. So I do think it's fair looking at a lot of the literature on consent that there tends to be a kind of a stronger deontological basis. I don't know if everybody that I'm pulling from would agree, but there seems to be quite a lot there, especially in models that are more on like the autonomous authorization kind of model that are really paying attention to kind of like my rights, my choice, all of these things. It's interesting that the shift is more kind of welfare based. I hadn't really thought about it like that. I do still think there's an importance to my rights and my kind of ability to, so on some theories of privacy, like Marmor, for example, thinks that we care about our privacy for actually social reasons, that it's still, I care about my privacy, but I care about sort of the ability to control what you all perceive, because that makes a difference between sort of collegial relations, like student teacher, good friend, parent, right, partner. All of those kind of differences have to do with how much information and what kinds of information people share. And so with that, right, so there is some sense in which I'm kind of retaining that, an aspect, I think, of control over your information. But I think it's importantly for kind of your individual rights purposes, as well as I think it's easy to point to some clear harms that happen. So I wouldn't think that they have to be kind of mutually exclusive. But yeah, I should think more about it. Super interesting.